Hello, and welcome to Rock Chapel. I'm Casey Finn, the pastor here. You know, it feels as though we are facing an unprecedented time, but we aren't. Not really. You see, history is full of situations just like this and worse. We've just been privileged to live during a time when it seems unusual. But really, historically speaking, our comfort and our freedom is what is unusual. I say that because I believe it's important for us to remember that as Christians, we are part of a universal church that includes believers in every age and every part of the world. And the same God who was with our early brothers and sisters as they faced the Roman emperor and his persecution by crucifying them along the streets is the same God who was with our Roman brothers and sisters during the sack of Rome. And he is the same God who guided our brothers and sisters through the Black Plague. And he is the same God who has sustained the world through war after war and through famine after famine and disease after disease. In other words, this virus may have caught us off guard, but it hasn't caught him off guard. Jesus still stands at the right hand of the Father, and our God is still sovereign over all. For now, we want to use the wisdom and the technology that he's given us by worshiping together online, a little different than what we're used to. So what does this mean for us? Well, we want to make today's worship service as interactive as possible. So I want to encourage you to share any prayer requests that you may have in the chat window right now and throughout the service. You know, share thoughts that you may have. Interact with one another. This is a time of fellowship. Even though we're separated in space, we are united in spirit. As we sing, I want to invite you to join with us. We'll even put the lyrics up on the screen to make it easy for you to sing. So please join with us, you know, as we sing these songs of praise. And right now, if you're in a group, I want to encourage you to designate someone who can pray out loud, because there will be a time during today's service when we'll just have some silence, maybe some quiet music, so that you can offer a prayer. We'll also have a time, as always, when you can give by either texting or visiting our website. I want to remind you, this is safe and secure. We've been doing it for about 2 years. And so at that time of our service, you'll see the information right there on your screen. I understand that this is not ideal, and I believe all of us are ready for the season of isolation that we're in to come to an end. But it doesn't have to hurt us or our spiritual walk. Just think of the ways that God is still at work. More churches than ever are getting the gospel out through the internet, and people are being reminded of the truly important things in life. And many people are spending more time with their families than they have in a very long time. I pray and I hope that we will remember the lessons we're learning long after COVID-19 is a little more than a memory. So let's do what we came here to do. Please join with me today as we worship our God and our King. The psalmist writes and says, "Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations."
Despairing cry from the waters lifted me. Now say, So true, bears my soul's best songs. Faithful, loving service to Him belongs. Love lifted me. Of the sea, billows His will obey. He, your Savior, wants to be saved today. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
At this time, we want to give you an opportunity to pray to our Father in heaven. And before we do, I want to read to you from Matthew chapter 6, and then I'm just going to give you at home an opportunity to spend a couple of minutes in prayer. Listen to what Jesus says. When you are praying, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them. for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. Pray then in this way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Use this time to offer up a prayer to God for any of the prayer requests that are in the comments or any of your own prayer requests. To you from the Gospel of John, chapter 11. This is likely a familiar story, especially if you've been in the church for a long time. You've probably heard this story preached on a number of times, discussed. I know I myself have preached on it several times. I've spoken at funerals from this text. And so this is maybe a familiar text, but I want us to take this and maybe look at how it applies to our lives and the situation that we're currently in. I've got kind of a lengthy scripture that I want to read to you. I'm going to read most of John chapter 11, and then we'll go back and we're going to look at it, and I want to just share with you some thoughts. like I said last week, it's really hard for me to consider this preaching. But let's just talk about the scriptures this morning. John 11 begins, "Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was the Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. So the sisters sent word to him, saying, 'Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick.' But when Jesus heard this, he said, 'This sickness is not to end in death, but for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified by it.' Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was sick, he then stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, 'Let us go to Judea again.' The disciples said to him, 'Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you, and are you going there again?' Jesus answered, 'Are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble because he sees the light of this world. But if anyone walks in the night, he stumbles because the light is not in him.' Then he said, this he said, and after that he said to them, 'Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go so that I may awaken him out of sleep.' The disciples then said to him, 'Lord, if he's fallen asleep, he will recover.' Now Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought he was speaking of literal sleep. So Jesus then said to them plainly, 'Lazarus is dead. And I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him.' Therefore Thomas, who is called Didymus, said to his fellow disciples, 'Let us also go, so that we may die with him.' So when Jesus came, he found that he had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. Martha, therefore, when she heard that Jesus was coming, went to meet him, but Mary stayed at the house. Martha then said to Jesus, 'Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. Even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you.' Jesus said to her, 'Your brother will rise again.' Martha said to him, 'I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day.' And Jesus said to her, 'I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?' She said to him, 'Yes, Lord. I have believed that you are the Christ, the Son of God, even he who comes into the world.' When she had said this, she went away and called Mary, her sister, saying secretly, 'The teacher is here and is calling for you.' And when she heard it, she got up quickly and was coming to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still in the place where Martha met him. Then the Jews who were with her in the house and consoling her, when they saw that Mary got up quickly and went out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep there. Therefore, when Mary came where Jesus was, she saw him and fell at his feet, saying to him, 'Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died.' When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and was troubled. And he said, 'Where have you laid him?' And they said to him, 'Lord, come and see.' And Jesus wept. So the Jews were saying, 'See how he loved him.' But some of them said, 'Could not this man who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man also from dying?' So Jesus again, being deeply moved within, came to the tomb. Now it was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. And Jesus said, 'Remove the stone.' Martha, the sister of the deceased, said to him, 'Lord, by this time there will be a stench, for he has been dead 4 days.' Jesus said to her, 'Did I not say to you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?' So they removed the stone. Then Jesus raised his eyes and said, 'Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but because of the people standing around, I said it, so that they may believe that you sent me.' When he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, 'Lazarus, come forth.' The man who had died came forth, bound hand and foot with wrappings, and his face was wrapped around with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, 'Unbind him and let him go.'" As this chapter opens, we see there is a major problem. The major problem is that Lazarus, whom Jesus loved, there you find down there in verse 3 or 4, is sick. It's not just any sickness. Lazarus is with the kind of sickness that ends in death, or at least appears to. Lazarus is sick with the kind of sickness that you don't come back from. Lazarus is sick in a way that his family and his friends have begun to gather because they know that his time is drawing short. That's the kind of sickness that Lazarus was experiencing. And if there was any time when Lazarus and Mary and Martha needed Jesus near, it was in this moment when Lazarus was nearing the end. After all, they'd heard that Jesus could heal. They'd probably seen Jesus heal themselves. I mean, they knew what he was capable of, and they knew that if he would just show up, if he just knew and could speak the word, that Lazarus would be healed. And so they send word to Jesus to try and get him to come in time, to try and get him to make it before Lazarus has died. I mean, if you've ever had someone on the brink of death and you've gone to God in prayer, you know how Mary and Martha must have felt, and Lazarus too, as they interceded on his behalf, as they cried out to God, God, please heal our brother Lazarus. As they sent someone to go get Jesus and then hoped and hoped and hoped that Jesus would show up. But he didn't. And in fact, what we read really makes this even more confusing at first glance, because it says, but when Jesus heard this, he said, this sickness is not to end in death, but for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified by it. And then we read in verse 5, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. He loved them, and yet in the very next verse, so, now if under normal circumstances, we would expect it to say, now Jesus loved Mary and her sister and Lazarus, so when he heard, he immediately took off. So when he heard, he fell on his face in prayer and sought God and said, God, heal Lazarus. But that's not what we read. Instead, what we read is, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, so when he heard that he was sick, he then stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. This must have been really confusing. It must have been confusing for the disciples to get the news that Lazarus was sick, and Jesus hears this news, and they know how Jesus loves Lazarus and Mary and Martha. And yet, when Jesus gets the news, he doesn't say, well, let's head out right now. We better make it before something happens. He says, we can take a couple of days. This must have been disheartening for Mary and Martha as they waited and watched the clock count down hour after hour and day after day. And 4 days pass from the time Lazarus, it looks like it's the end before, you know, Jesus starts to make his way, and it's 4 days after Lazarus has died that Jesus shows up. How discouraging this must have been for Mary and Martha, and for Lazarus as he waited for Jesus and then breathed his last. You know, our world is in a state not too unlike Lazarus. Our world is sick. And I'm not just talking about the virus. I mean, obviously, we're all concerned about the physical sickness that's going on around us, and not just with this virus, but with the flu and with other sicknesses and with violence and with the murder rate and with abortion and with everything in our world where lives are physically being lost. It concerns us, and it should. And we look around us, and we could be tempted to say, God, don't you know that the world is dying, is sick, and is near death, and won't you come and do something? But that's not even all. The world's not just sick physically. We're sick psychologically and mentally. So many of us are broken and anxious and fearful and full of doubt. We live in an incredibly anxious age. For all of the benefits and privileges that we have living in the 21st century with all of our technology, we have a lot of fear. and a lot of anxiety and a lot of uncertainty. And it drives a lot of us crazy, not just, you know, hypothetically or metaphorically, but literally. The suicide rate from 1999 to 2014 in the United States increased by 24%, and then from 2014 to 2018 it jumped even more. We are sick psychologically and physically. We're sick financially. I mean, we were doing okay about a month ago, but don't even look at the stock market today. Don't look at where we're sort of looks like we're heading. Our world is sick financially, and on top of all of that, if that wasn't bad enough, we're sick spiritually, because there's so many of us that are distracted and focused on everything else in the world other than God and other than what He desires for us. And we're off running after this and running after that. We have been spiritually sick for a long time, this world and this country. And as we sort of survey our surroundings and our land and our planet, we find a planet that is sick, not unlike Lazarus. And yet, when Jesus hears the word about Lazarus, that Lazarus is sick and is dying, Jesus gives them a little bit of perspective. He says, "This sickness is not to end in death, but for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified by it." Now, the messengers and the disciples who heard Jesus say that, they probably wouldn't have totally understood. They would have assumed that Lazarus was not going to die. Jesus was going to make it in time and He was going to heal them. But we have the benefit of hindsight, and what we know is Lazarus was going to die. So when Jesus said this sickness is not to end in death, but for the glory of God, the reality is there was a time when it did end in death, where Lazarus really was dead, where he was in the tomb. In fact, he was in the tomb for 4 days, so long that when Martha hears Jesus say, "Open the tomb," she says, "Jesus, I don't know that you're going to want to do that, because it's going to stink." So Jesus says this sickness is not to end in death. And yet we know that for at least 4 days it did. Why does Jesus say that? Because Jesus understands that there's a larger time scale at play. That just because something happens in the immediate doesn't mean that it happens once and for all. That because we face problems right now doesn't mean that those problems have the final word. That because death creeps up in this life right now, in these moments, doesn't mean that it gets the final word. That because sickness threatens us now does not mean that sickness will have the final word. Because financial problems and psychological and mental problems and spiritual problems seem to be all around us right now does not mean that they will have the final word. In fact, those problems one day we'll see not as the final word on how things are and were and will be, but instead we'll see that even in the midst of all those problems, God was using them and working through them and weaving together things in the midst of them for the glory of God, as it says there in verse 4, so that the Son of God may be glorified by it. Look, this is the cross, right? This is Easter. This is Good Friday. Is Jesus is beaten and he's tortured and he's crucified, and it looks like God has lost and righteousness has lost and holiness has lost and humanity has lost, and it seems like it's the end for Friday and Saturday. And then Sunday morning comes and the tomb is broken open and Christ is raised from the dead. And what He reveals in that resurrection and through His power is that death and sin and sickness does not have the final word or the final say. God does. And His glory does. And so even when everything seems to be going off the rails, God still has the last word. And He always will, because He is sovereign. You see, because God is sovereign, because He is in control, He is able to take the worst
circumstances and situations that we find ourselves in, and He is able to weave through them glory, His glory. He's able to weave through death, resurrection. He's able to weave through sickness, healing, and wholeness. This is what Christ is going to do, but it's still going to take Lazarus dying. And just like with Jesus, in order to get to Easter, he had to go through Good Friday. If we read verses 5 and 6, again we see, "Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, so when he heard that he was sick, he then stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was." And we hear this, and it seems cruel. Why would Jesus stay 2 days longer? And why would it say that he loved them so then? You know why? I think John tells us, verse 5, because he wants us to know, before we ever get to the bad news, before we ever get to this, you know, Jesus holding off, him not coming right this second, he wants to reassure us that he loves us. Jesus loved Mary and Martha and Lazarus. He held off and he didn't go, but it wasn't because he didn't love them. He did love them. He loved them deeply. In fact, it was that love maybe that even spurred him to wait, because he saw the glory that was going to come out of Lazarus's death and resurrection. Jesus had a greater perspective than Mary and Martha did. And sometimes in our lives, we have things happen to us, or we have situations, or we find ourselves like we are in a circumstance, like we are now, that we're not fond of and that we wish we weren't in. And I know, I understand, I'm with you. And it's easy for us to go in the midst of those, to find ourselves in the midst of those circumstances and to look around and say, well, God must just have forgotten about me. God must just not really love me the way that I thought. You know, I thought Scripture said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." That's what my Sunday school teacher taught me. And yet right now I find myself in this circumstance and I'm wondering, God, where are you? And why aren't you doing something? Where's your love? And what John wants to remind us of is even in the delay, even when it seems like God is putting us off, his love has not diminished. He's called Lazarus already, "Behold, Lord, he whom you love is sick." And then we come to verse 5. "Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus." And I want to encourage you and remind you that no matter what's going on in your life, no matter how bad things seem, no matter what has gone wrong, it has not diminished the love that God has for you, because God's love is not contingent upon my circumstances. God's love does not depend on me always having everything the way that I want it. And the things that happen in my life, the problems that I face, do not define the love that God has for me or for you. God's love transcends those things. It transcends my circumstances and my problems. Now, when Jesus puts this off, he talks to his disciples, he explains to them that Lazarus is dying and that they're going to go and they're going to see Lazarus. And Martha meets Jesus. You know, I can imagine Martha and Mary sitting in the house and weeping because Lazarus has been dead for 4 days, and they're grieving, and all friends and family are gathered there, and they're grieving Lazarus's death. And I can imagine someone looking out the window and seeing these 13 figures making their way towards the house, and immediately this person knows who this is, that this is Jesus and his 12 disciples. And somebody says, "Oh, it's Jesus." And Martha goes running. I mean, she is out the door before the words even finish coming out of the guy's mouth, you know? And she runs out that door and makes her way down the path, and she meets Jesus before he can even get to their house. And she says to him, "Lord, if you would have been here, my brother wouldn't have died." And she says, "Even now I know God would do anything you ask." And Jesus looks at her, and he gives her hope. That's what we need. We need someone to speak a word of hope. We need hope from God. We need God to speak some hope into our lives. Maybe you feel a little bit like Martha, and you're kind of anxious about what's going on, and the slightest news that you get that maybe something's coming your way, you're up and you're running looking for it. You're online searching for the latest news, the latest treatment, whatever it happens to be, and you're feeling that anxiousness like Martha. And you want somebody to speak a word of hope. And that's what Jesus does. He offers hope. And I think he would offer you and me the same hope that he offers to Martha. He says, your brother will rise again. And he gives her hope. And she immediately assumes that he's talking about the resurrection, you know, way off in the future when God, the kingdom, is summed up and God makes everything right. And Jesus says to her, I am the resurrection and the life, and he who believes in me will live even if he dies, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? And she says, yeah, I do. I believe you. I believe you're the Son of God, that you're the Messiah, Martha says. Mary comes out and meets Jesus, and eventually Jesus says, I want to go. I want to go to the tomb. And we read here in verse 33, when Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and was troubled and said, where have you laid him? And they said to him, Lord, come and see. And then we have this little two-word verse, the shortest verse in the English Bible. And Jesus wept. So the Jews were saying, see how he loved him. See how he loved them. Jesus weeps for us. He enters into our world with all of the dirt and the filth and the suffering, and he suffers alongside us, and he weeps with us. And as we look at everything that's going on in our world, it is easy to get this picture of God that he is up there, transcendent, beyond everything, and that he doesn't feel for our suffering and our pain. And that's just not true. He weeps. He weeps when we weep. He suffers. Jesus suffers with us. That's what the crucifixion is all about. He's entering into the suffering of humanity. He's taking our suffering and our sin and our shame and our punishment and our death all in himself. And he's putting it all to death. And he suffers with us. This is the word that we need to remember more than any other as we suffer in this life. That we have a God who is a Lord who is the resurrection and the life, a Lord who speaks hope to you and to me, and we have a Lord who has come and entered into our world and who suffers alongside of us, who's not afraid of hurting right next to us. And when you feel the hurt and the suffering, Jesus is there with you. The book of Hebrews says that he is standing at the right hand of the Father, that he's interceding for us all the time, that he's praying for us. He's going to the Father on our behalf. He's interceding for us. He stands at the right hand of God the Father, representing us and our hurts and our suffering, representing all that we are to God and representing all that God is to us. Christ has suffered. He knows what it's like to go through the things that you and I are going through, and worse. This is the kind of God that we have. And then he acts. See, God loves us, and he's moved by us, and he suffers with us. But he doesn't just end in suffering. Instead, he acts to bring about new life. And this is what we find right after this, where he says to them, remove the stone. And they kind of, you know, hem-haw, no, I don't know if we want to do that. It's going to smell really bad. And he says, I'm telling you, remove the stone. So they remove the stone in verse 41. And then Jesus raised his eyes and he prays to the Father and says, God, I know you've heard me and I thank you for that. And I'm saying this for the sake of everybody that's listening right now, because the crowd had gathered there to watch what was going on. I mean, there were lots of people there grieving Lazarus, and now they're watching at the tomb with Jesus there. And then he cries out, Lazarus, come forth. And the man who had died, come forth. Lazarus came forth bound hand and foot with wrappings, and his face was wrapped around with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. You see, it is not our circumstances and our problems or our death that defines God's love for us. Instead, it is the work God is doing in our lives. It is the work He is doing. It is the love that He expresses in our lives. He is the God of new life, and He desires to bring that new life to you and to me. Here's the reality, and this is what part of what I think that we need to remember and we need to learn from this story as we go through this season of isolation and this season of suffering. And it's this, that things have to die in order for there to be a resurrection. Jesus had to die on Good Friday in order for Him to be raised on Easter and to impart new life to you and to me and to all those who will put their faith in Jesus. And Lazarus had to die in order for him to be raised and for Christ to be glorified through this miracle and for, I mean, can you imagine all the impact? And I want to encourage you with this word that when Lazarus went into the tomb, I guarantee you that he was a different man when he came out. That he was a different man after suffering through this illness and after literally dying and being literally put into a tomb for 4 days, that Mary and Martha and Lazarus and their family and friends, as they endured this suffering, this season of suffering, they were different people when it was over. That Lazarus was a different man when he came out of that tomb than when he went in. That Mary and Martha were different women when they came away from that tomb with their brother by their side than they were when they carried his dead body to that tomb and laid him to rest, believing that it was the last time that they were going to see him. They were different people. And it is the same way with us. This is what repentance is. Repentance is us dying to ourselves. That's what Paul says, that we crucify ourselves. It is dying to ourselves so that new life can be created. That's what repentance is, that we allow our old ways, our old idolatrous, selfish ways to be put away so that new life can be born. And it's the same way with the situation that we're in. We find ourselves in sort of a tomb-like state. We're all isolated. We've been separated from one another. We can't hug one another or touch one another. You can't even really go out without feeling suspicious of people. And what's that cough? And what's that sneeze? We find ourselves in a kind of death, in a kind of tomb. But I believe that if we will put our faith in Christ and walk with Him faithfully through this, we will be different people when we walk out of this tomb. We will be transformed. And there will be some things that we thought we could never live without that we'll realize, because we've had to, that we not only can, but maybe we're a little better off for having lived without them. That God wants to do a work in your life and in mine. He wants to do a work in this congregation and in the church around the world, I fully believe. And He's going to do that work through this suffering and through this tomb. And it's going to be hard and it's going to be uncomfortable and everything else. But I believe wholeheartedly that if we will have faith and if we'll keep on and if we'll persevere, that we will be transformed people when we walk out of this tomb. And so I pray that you and that I will suffer with Christ in the midst of this, suffer well, and look forward with hope to Jesus, the resurrection and the life, and the work that He is going to do in you and me. Be not dismayed. Fear not. Don't be discouraged. We have a God who is bigger than all of our problems through all of this sickness and through everything that's going wrong.
Shout.
I hope and pray that this morning service found you well. I'm going to ask if you would, please like and share the video. This is really an unprecedented time for us. We have the opportunity to get the gospel out in a way that nobody on earth has been able to do until just the past 10 years. And so when you share that video, it's an easy way to share the message of Jesus and the hope that we have in Christ with friends and with family. If you have any prayer requests, please let us know. Send us, you can comment, you can send us a private message. If there's anything that we as a congregation can do, those leaders in the congregation, let us know. If you're older or have a compromised immune system and you don't want to get out, you need somebody to go get groceries or go pick up a prescription, just let me know. Send me a message through Facebook and we will do what we can to meet whatever your needs are. I do want to let you know just a couple of announcements. Tonight we will do a live stream. I'm going to just continue the study on Colossians that I started this past week, and we will do that study on Colossians on Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday at 6 o'clock. On Wednesday at 7 o'clock, we will be having our theology class that we started this past week. It was very well attended this last week, and so I hope to see you there. I think it's going to be really fun. I've been enjoying it. So be aware of that. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday at 6, we're going to be going through Colossians. Wednesday at 7, we're going to be looking at theology. Next Sunday morning, we will have another service, online service, just like this, unless God does something and you know, changes things. That's what our plan is. Beyond that, we do not know. We're waiting to hear what the government says, what President Trump and his team recommend, and we will likely try our best to follow the CDC's recommendations because we want to do our part in putting a stop to this virus. So just be aware that our plans may change. Our hope is that we'll be able to announce our plans going forward, if not on Sunday, then Monday at the latest of next week. So be aware of that. We pray that you're doing well and that you will continue to do well. We love you. We appreciate you. If you have anything you need, just send us a message. Also, real quick, last thing. Every day, I'm going to be right outside the church from 1 to 2. I'll be there today, as well as every other day. If you want to come by and pray, if you just want somebody to talk to, if you want somebody to vent to, drop by and we'll talk and we'll pray. You don't even have to get out of your car. You just pull up. I'm sitting right there at the under the awning. We can talk and then we can stay 6 feet away, keep our social distancing in order, and then when we're done, you can just drive on out. So just want you to be aware of that. That the church and you know, we've not gone anywhere. We're still here. We just want to do what we can to put a stop to this virus so that we can get on with our lives. We love y'all. We appreciate y'all, and we're looking forward to seeing you soon. God bless you.